Good morning on another beautiful Lord's Day morning. They come and go so fast, and it is a beautiful Lord's Day morning, and that day of the week that Christians have for centuries been very faithful in the worship and the memory of Christ. And so we do so once more today. This is Pastor Jim again this morning. As we come to our devotional time this morning, we would like to use an illustration to start with to elucidate the theme for today. The illustration has to do with an automobile. We could use one of dozens of other illustrations, like a lawnmower or a weed whacker or a stove or a fridge or a mixer in a kitchen, simply dozens of other things. But the use of an automobile can likely make the illustration a little more meaningful because of the size, the complexities, and the gadgets connected with it. As you know, a car always comes with a book or a manual that spells out a whole lot of things about the car, about how to take care of it, how to keep it performing well, things to look out for, cautions that can damage it, simply just all kinds of things that will make it last for a long time without a lot of problems. And if you do run into problems, what to do about those problems. It might be helpful here for us to take some time to actually think about the ultimate ramifications of learning and following the information in that manual or in that book and its use. That is an illustration of the theme we moved to last week of the blessings we have from our Creator, from God who made us. The first blessing we have from Him is that we simply are. He created us. That is, He conceived us in mind and plans. He formed us. He breathed into us the breath of life, and we became living souls. The crowning feature of all creation. The rest of creation would have meant nothing if there were no being here to appreciate it, to know it, to understand it, to take pleasure in it. That was our real blessing to begin with, the first blessing that we have ever had as a human being. We are here. We are the object, the result of those cogitations and designs of an almighty God. That compares through much superiority with the development of a car designed and built to be used in very positive ways. The second blessing, which is what we will share today, is the manual or the books which contain the information which can make the car actually do, over a long period of time, what it was designed to do. That information is produced and written by the company which made it, written by authors who were guided by the designers of the car and made available to those who use it to keep it running. That scenario relates to the second great blessing we have from our Creator, from our Lord. He not only designed us, that first blessing, created us, making us who we are, but He also has put out His own information and working manual, which we now call the Bible, which contains the information and directions for our lives, which can help make us to be able to be and to do what He designed us to be and to do. It tells us who we are, where we came from, and gives us guidance for our lives, including cautions that can destroy or weaken our lives. He used some 40 different writers to record it, but also made it clear that His Spirit guided the information that has been recorded and passed on to us. What is there is more than just human thought or human opinion. It is the knowledge and wisdom of our Creator being passed on to us by His initiative through fellow human beings. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 puts it this way. All Scripture, that is the Bible, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. What greater blessing can we have than this? Having been initially blessed by the divine creation of us, God reveals Himself, who we are, and all of the fine arts of life, that as the passage says, that the man of God may be complete, furnished completely to every good work. One can ask for nothing better than this. The Bible is our manual for life, for a good life. It can make a major difference in how we live it out. It can and has changed the course of individual lives, and it has also changed the course of human life on the whole on this planet for the very best. We would like to go on today and explain the great implications of this, the second greatest blessing which we have from our Creator. He gave us the greatest manual of life for living that we could possibly hope for. This is summed up in one of those beautiful hymns. We've had it before, but it's certainly worth listening to once more. It's simply called Ancient Words.
World.
Let's go back now to our car illustration. If we follow all of the guidelines for the operation and care of the car, we can expect it to last for years and give reasonable, good, trouble-free service. It can give years of pleasure and transportation for work, for activities, for all kinds of things, or for just enjoyment of travel itself. It's a real blessing. But if we don't follow the guidelines, the blessings and values of its service can be cut very short and give us all kinds of grief and problems. It is designed for good, clean fuel of the right kind. If that fuel gets altered or polluted, it can destroy the engine in a mighty short time. For example, some years ago, some vandals at one time were known to put sugar in the gas tanks of some of their competitors, and the engines of their machines were destroyed in a very short period of time. One needs to change oil in accordance with the guidelines, or the engines wear out sooner. If one lets the oil get mixed with antifreeze, again the engine can be destroyed. Failure to faithfully lubricate the mechanical working parts will wear out the joints in the car's system. These are some of the basics, and they're outlined in that book that we have talked about of instructions and guidance. Following the rules are basic to good results. They are a blessing. So are the divine guidelines in the guidelines, the book that God has given to us, the rules by which he has taught us to live in his revelation to us in Scripture. They too are vital for us, and there are some of them that are very basic if we're going to have anything like a good life. Jesus put it all in capsule form when he said that there were two commandments upon which everything else, the law and the prophets, rested. The first was to love God with all of our hearts, and the second was to love our fellow man as we love ourselves. A good life is dependent upon these two basic guidelines spelled out in that book that we have talked about. There is no goodness where there is no caring of either one or both, only poor relationships, hardships, and conflict. The second tier of those guidelines are the Ten Commandments, given to the ancient Jewish people through Moses. That would be about 3,500 years ago. After those 3,500 years, they are still basic in today's world. They are the foundation of the most civilized peoples of the world. Civilized law is based fundamentally upon them. Human rights rise above human opinions or decisions, and often are deemed to be from an Almighty, whatever the concept of the Almighty might be. They are not subject to the decisions of one person, or of royalty, or of a dictator, or of an oligarchy, or even a parliament with a majority. They're called, in one major quarter, inalienable rights. That is, they are beyond the ability of any human to alter them, because they have been given to us by the divine Creator. The first four commandments of the Ten Commandments are given to protect this concept of that Creator and the reality of his place in our lives. There are to be no other gods, that's number one. There are to be no idols, that's number two. They're not to take the name of the Lord in vain. In other words, they're to hold God in reverence. That's number three. And then to keep the Sabbath, to keep the day of memory and connection with the divine, to support that relationship. Then add to these four commandments two of the next three that protect the human family as the building block of humanity. Children are to obey their parents, that's number five. And parents are to be faithful to each other, that's number seven. And in between at number six, between those two, there is an absolute respect for the sacredness of life itself, where it says that thou shalt not kill. And then for safety and security of one's environment, the eighth one says, thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet anything that is thy neighbor's. In the midst of all of this is one more that instructs us to not bear false witness. That is to lie to and about one another. These are fundamental and basic to a civilized world of safety, security, and good relationships and a functioning society. We are such only to the degree that we have recognized and lived by these commandments as living beings, crafted by the hand of God Himself. They have been a real blessing to us, and they have been garnished by the rest of the divine Spirit-revealed teachings of the Old Testament, and then crowned by the even higher principles in ethics and morality by none other than Christ Himself, who came and lived among us, and then spelled out and explained more in the New Testament itself, which is really the direct and important part that relates to us as Christians today. Their elevator standards are now our even higher standards of living. These together make life, the worldly life that we live, better for everyone, and they are a wonderful blessing given to enhance our lives. They form a foundation for life. And this hymn is How Firm a Foundation. Thank you.
fiery trials, your pathway shall lie. My grace all sufficient shall be your supply. The flame shall not hurt you, I only design. Your dross to consume and your gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus has leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foe.
We are very hopeful this morning that these devotionals that we are sharing now will have a focus upon the blessings we have from God, and that they will come to be a great inspiration for us to be more actively appreciating just who God is and what He means to us. Last Lord's Day, we focused upon His blessings of creating us, making us who and what we are. How can we help but be really appreciative to be here, to be alive, to enjoy life as we do? And then, as we have shared today, that God did not leave us just to ourselves to sort out the issues and means of life, to have the best possible life while we're here. As with an automobile, He gave us a manual by which we can have the best possibilities of life here and now. On this theme, we have a great and wonderful passage of Scripture that shares the clarity of that reality. It is contained in the first three verses of Hebrews chapter 1, where it says there, God, who at various times and in various manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son, whom He hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also He made the worlds, who being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person, and upholding all things by the word of His power, when He had Himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. That is such a clear passage. It is clear to say that in times past, God has spoken. He has spoken in various ways, through various people, and at various times. As history unfolded, He kept alive His contact with we humans to unfold and guide us along life's journey. And then He sent Christ to live, to minister, and to die amongst us for our redemption. This is the story of the unfolding of the biblical record by some 40 authors over a period of several hundred years. Actually, a few thousand years, and it is alive and active today to continue in that mission. That is what the particular writing was written to emphasize. Its influence continues to be an unfolding influence for the blessing of all of humanity, even in these times in which we live. We would like to trace some of the historic unfolding of that, so that we can appreciate what our Lord has done for us in a little better way. It starts with Adam and Eve at the point of creation. Three instructions were given to them to begin with. The first was to manage the affairs of the planet that we're on. The second was to populate the planet. And the third was to not eat of one special tree in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God did not want evil to become a part of human life. They were to be able to live forever and enjoy everything if they abided in these three instructions. Otherwise, they were cautioned that they would experience death. They chose to disregard the instructions, and death came upon the human race. Their first children, Cain and Abel, were instructed regarding sacrifices, to offer a blood sacrifice. Cain chose to do otherwise and became envious of his brother who did what he was supposed to do and had the favor of God, and he killed his brother. The world conditions continued to deteriorate until God chose Noah and guided him to build an ark to save humanity from total extinction. And then he turned to his offering, his offspring, a few generations later, to Abraham and his descendants, to settle in what we now call the Promised Land or the Holy Land, and then to Moses, to form them into a nation, and then to the prophets like Samuel and Elijah and Elisha and Isaiah and Jeremiah and quite a number of others, to guide them onward to the coming of Christ the Messiah. The whole unfolding of the Old Testament is the unfolding of our Creator's contact and guidance of human life towards what we ought to be, but so often we respond like Adam and Eve and Cain in not following that guidance, and we suffer badly the consequences of not following it. It's kind of like getting sugar in your gas tank or antifreeze in your oil pan. It is hard for us to realize what the world would be like today if it were not for the influence of the blessings of the divine revelation that has been given to us in the way that we should go that is held in Scripture. The best of what we call civilization is none other than the implementation of many of these great principles and guidance matters that were a part of that unfolding of His will for us. The more we follow His will, the better it is for us and the better life we have. We have so much for which to be grateful for the great blessing of God sharing His operator's manual for us as His creation. It is a wonderful blessing indeed. The hymn, Your Word, speaks very much to this theme.
Ever faithful.
As we come to our communion time today, Christ gathered with his disciples in the upper room just before his arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane. It was the Passover time, a time to remember the deliverance of the children of Israel out of Egypt, just before the Ten Commandments were given. And they were taught to remember, never to forget what had been done to save them from their difficult slavery to the Egyptian people. It was a real time for them to recount those things and to be brought to the reality of the place of God in their lives. And in the midst of that, Jesus took the loaf and the cup. He broke the bread and gave them the cup and asked them to do that in remembrance of him. He is the core of our relationship with the divine. He is the source of our strength. And through the communion service, we're called upon to remember, and then in Corinthians, to examine ourselves, to look at ourselves, and renew our relationship with him. This is so fundamental, so that we do not forget that book of guidelines, the way for us to live for him who died for us. May we remember him today around the table and renew our faith and relationship with him. Our Father in heaven, as we come this morning in this communion time, we're so thankful for what it means that we're called upon to remember Christ and his love for us and his sacrifice for us to redeem us back unto thee. Help us, our Father, to remember that we have failed in many ways and we need forgiveness. And we look to thee today and ask that you would guide us and forgive us and give us renewed strength to walk another week with Thee and to do better. Guide us now through this day, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for sharing with us once more this morning, and we do hope and pray that you will have a wonderful week ahead and that all will be well in your lives. Let's follow the manuscript, the book, the directions that God has given us for our lives. God bless and take care. This is Pastor Jim.